Well, thank you very much. And first of all, let me say I'm very happy to be with you today. In my position at UNESCO, as you said, in the past 8 years I was the director general of culture, and in the previous 10 years I was the director of the World Heritage Center. And that position, you know, it doesn't happen very often that you encounter this. You encounter researchers and scholars and so on, because they're very busy with other things. You know, not that you don't want, but you're very busy. So I always try, also because I have an academic background, always try during my mandate to push forward the discussion, try to engage the world of research, of academy, in the implementation of policies that were cooked up at UNESCO. I think it went quite well. You know, for a long time we were able to, you know, hybridate the two worlds, the world of bureaucrats and the world of researchers. I don't know which, none of them is denigratory. None of these terms is denigratory. And so what I would like today to pass on to you is a little bit of a story of this this itinerary, this discussion that we had in the past 10-15 years on the issue of urban heritage, because I think it has been an important advancement. It has been an area where the traditional idea and concepts that surround heritage have been shaken by reality, and where we were able, I think, at least to address some of the issues that are coming in front of us through an effort of redesign, redefinition, reinterpretation, reconnection of our discourse, traditional discourse on heritage, with a system of thinking that comes from other parts of the UN system, and that I think has vastly enriched the very approach that UNESCO has been spearheading. 33 years. So I will, of course, the issue, as you will see, is rather complex, also because cities are a very difficult object to deal with. They're very, they're like a Proteus, you know, you see them, but you're hard to catch. You know? It's very, very hard to end a lecture on cities saying, well, we have gone through, through the issues. They always leave issues on the table. So I give up from the beginning. I will not try to reach any definite conclusion. I will try to leave things on the table for you to get inspirations, some agenda, research agenda, some directions, some issues that we think are relevant for today and the future. Because there is no other alternative. Right? It is an ongoing process, and will always be. What we have done is essentially trying to capture some of the elements and frame it in documents, text, experiences that are visible and known, and perhaps we can exchange on that. But certainly, I have no pretension that we have found any any truth or any solution for it. What I would like to talk about today, but I will give you some background, is this document. Because it's very dear to my heart. I spent over 2 years just in manufacturing the research behind this. And we call it Culture of Urban Future. It's one of those big bricks that the UN publishes regularly, and has the advantage that you can download it from the web for free in 3 languages. 4 very soon. It's in English, French, and Spanish. There is a Spanish here, right? Who's a Spanish here? Spanish.
Or several.
So what? Based in
Spain. Okay, there, that answer. And also, we're doing it now in Chinese, and we'll see. We'll see. And I had the pleasure to give it to you as a gift to the library. It says advantage, I don't have to bring it back. It's very heavy. document is really the result of a long, long itinerary. And a lot of it, as you know, was traced even before I was born. So I think we need to know that there is always long history behind things. And of course, we don't have to, you know, give history more than it is what's valued for, but we have to know that history is behind. Okay, this is something the UN normally is never a historical perspective, but I like to put it up very clear on the contrary that we do root everything we do on the history of conservation, the history of heritage, and the history of urban heritage, which is a very specific subcategory of heritage, which has, as you will see, very specific characteristics and nature. And unless we know this, we will never be able to understand why, you know, we reach certain conclusions or why we address the issues through certain policies. So, of course, I will not give you a history lesson now because there is no time. I would love to, because I'm very passionate. But if you are interested in the history that I'm going to say, I put it in a book, which is called The Historic Urban Landscape. I have here the Italian version of it. This is the only book of mine that has been translated in six languages. I'm very proud of it. Italian, Chinese, French, what's the same, of course, and Russian. So, no, it's, so. I have it here, the Italian version, which of course I'm very happy also to leave to the library. Very happy to leave it here, so I can bring it back. And but on condition that you buy the English version, so yeah, because it was actually written in English. This is a translation. And you know, I spent about half of this book on trying to understand where we come from, you know, in terms of human heritage. And finally, and I finish with this, there's another book, this one in English, Reconnecting the City. You have it? You do have it.
Because this,
you do have it, because this is also remaining in Bologna. Okay. So, three books. Which is the expansion of the concept and the methodology for, you know, implementation of the ideas that we have developed in the other book. In these books, we look at the history of urban heritage as a specific type category, and found out that, in fact, it's something that came out very late. Heritage has existed as an object of public policies, an object of interest also of the public for a very long time before we could even speak about urban heritage. And I think the only first trace that I really find in terms of textures and texts and so on, it comes from the 1930s, where we have the first charter, first document that we can call it the international heritage document, the Athens Conference, 1931, not to be confused with the Athens Conference of 1933, which is the one that somehow enshrined the modern movement in architecture, but this is 1931, which is largely inspired by an Italian architect and thinker, Gustavo Giovannoni, very famous in the field that we're dealing with, who was perhaps the first one, the first operational thinker of the historic city. The first, although there were many other people before him, and of course if you look at the history you will find out the details, but it's the first one that really gave an operational slant, you know, to the idea of preserving historic cities. He was living in the 1920s and 30s, he was a very major figure during that time, the creator of the first world architecture in Italy. I mean, he's a chief figure in the field of architecture and urban planning, but also internationally. He was the one that instilled the idea of the Athens Conference, internationalization of heritage and policies, as it's very important for UNESCO, of course, methodology. His approach was, you know, you have to remember that at that time, and all throughout the 19th century and the first half of the 20th century, essentially historic cities were seen as areas to be demolished, you know, to be substituted by modern fabric. You've been certainly to Paris, you know. The Paris you see today is the exact manifestation of the idea, because from 1850 to 1870, you know, the entire historic areas of Paris were leveled to the ground to make space to a new city, which was, you know, of course, what we now perceive heritage. It's always it's always like this, you know, as time goes by, it's become a heritage. But the Haussmannian Paris, which was the model for all the cities of Europe and beyond for a century and even today, was essentially based on the, you know, replacement of entire sectors of the city. You go to Middle East, for instance, today, they do exactly the same thing. You know, Baghdad, places like, you know, Jeddah, or places like this, they operate exactly in the same way. They do exactly what the Europeans did in the 19th and 20th century. But Giovannoli saw, on the contrary, the value of historic places, and tried to advance an idea that, in fact, historic places could be safeguarded, could be brought to modernity. That was the idea, because they were seen as essentially as only as a negative area, so where, you know, there was misery and lack of hygiene and criminality and all the worst part. So, of course, to do that, you have to improve the conditions. So his teaching is essentially on that, how you improve the conditions of historic areas so that you bring them up to, you know, to a level that is acceptable for modern standards. Well, his idea, of course, was applied to Rome and many other places, sometimes successfully, sometimes less successfully. His idea was essentially to clean up a little bit, try to take away from the historic areas those parts that were, you know, excessive, making lower the density essentially of the historic areas, which, by the way, is what was done very successfully in Bologna many years later, you know, by just, you know, purifying a little bit the historic fabric, bring it back sometimes, you know, to an equilibrium that they had reached maybe in the Middle Ages or Renaissance, and then they lost through time. So I think that's important, because, you know, in a way, he was the first one that gave value to the preservation of historic areas according to certain conditions. And throughout this, and through this thinking, and through the extension of the Athens Charter, Athens Conference ideas, we, and of course you have to remember that, you know, at the end of the 30s there was the war, so for 15, 20 years nobody did anything on heritage, there were other priorities. But when, you know, the thinking came back, we had finally an important document, which we call the Charter of Venice. If you have never heard, but I'm sure you do, maybe if you never heard, have a look, because this charter has a great advantage, it's one page. Nobody charters are very long, especially the one we write today. But this one is one page, and one page you have, you know, a set of principles that are probably the most important, say, synthesis, a summary of 200 years of thinking about, you know, heritage and so on. Of course, this was done, as I said, the name Venice, which happens to be my city, but that's another story. And by a group of people that were essentially art historians, conservators, museologists, architects also, but not much, certainly not urban planners. So the focus is really on heritage as an object, as an art object. And in fact, most of the principles that are expressed there apply very well to monuments, isolated monuments, or works of art. I think, you know, the moment you go into a different kind of heritage like cities are, things become a little bit shaky, because you know, then you have a heritage that is living, that is used, that is changing, that is is a fragmented you know, management processes and properties, ownerships, and so on. And many of the principles that are expressed in the Charter of Venice collapse when you when you try to deal or to apply them directly to cities, to historic cities. And this was became very clear from the beginning. So I'm not going to give you the long story because it's in the book. But essentially, the group of people that were around this issue realized that there was a great lack of understanding of the complexity of urban management, and so they created a new charter, which is called the Charter of Washington, the Carta del Charter of Washington, 1987, 30 years now. And this charter is the one that focuses on the city proper, on the city as a heritage, and defines principles that are necessary to manage something that is completely different in terms of nature and so on. As you will see, as soon as you read this chapter, you realize that you know, 30 years are a very, very long time, because and 30 years ago, which is before you were born, of course, the approach was very different from today. For instance, you know, as you will see in this chapter, there is a great trust on the state as the manager of a heritage conservation. At that time, governments were much more involved in heritage preservation than today, and they had more powers. But I think that if you read today, you realize that things have changed. Now, you see, so in 60s, 70s, and 80s were very important years. But at the same time, there were years in which you know, the historic cities also suffered a lot of changes and sometimes traumatic. You may have seen, if you have been to Paris, you know, the center of Paris, you know, where the famous market, you know, the Arles, were located. And this is in the 70s, you know, exactly the same time, where this principle were discussed and enshrined in the charters and was completely demolished. So you had a major impact in the very heart of the city of processes that came from another concept, you know, the Osmanian cleaning up of the dirty parts of the city and so on. By the way, it was one of the most unsuccessful urban regeneration projects on Earth. One complete failure of design, of public approval, of uses. I mean, they created literally a desert in the center, in the center of the city, to the point that you know, a few years ago they had to redesign the entire thing and try to make it a little more attractive, because it was really, I think it's impossible to make it attractive. So they spent a huge amount of money to create a new infrastructure there, which is a way to correct you know, the initial mistakes of this project. But clearly, this has some limitations. So just to show you how. And so at that time, there was a very important push to go from theory to practice, from the charters to the management processes. I think Italy was an important point, and I will come back to this, but certainly the first laws were in France. This is Marot, Minister of Culture around the world, who had decided to save the French historic centers. And so he created this this mechanism, which is still there, the law of Marot, which he was essentially subsidizing heritage conservation processes in areas that were deemed to be heritage. So he created what in France is called the safeguarded sectors. Sectors, we call it the safeguarded sectors. You know, areas of the city where, okay, this one for instance, the city of Arles, you know, where inside the perimeter, that perimeter, you have certain mechanisms, procedures, mechanisms, financial incentives and regulations are different from the rest of the city. I think it's important to focus on this because as of today, with some exceptions, which I also mentioned, this is the way in which historic cities are managed in the world. Essentially, district, there's a district definition of district, an area, which is defined as historic, inside which different regulations apply, in terms of height management, construction, materials, colors, shapes, blah, 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 architectural stuff, and in which other mechanisms for support mechanisms, incentives, essentially subsidies, or tax deductions, which is the same thing, apply. There's no, we haven't found a better one. We have not found a better mechanism. And if you go around the world, essentially, you have all the cities that have some historic significance have done the same thing. And then define a perimeter, which for instance, the case of Naples, you find it everywhere. This is even in India, we have the same thing. I'm just talking about something that's so general, it's so universal that you find it everywhere. Right? Essentially, it's the model. Now, why do I insist on this? Because this model has been very effective. In fact, cities that have adopted this model have safeguarded their internal, their historic areas, because they have provided additional resources for the conservation and because they have regulated transformation of those areas in a very specific way. So it's a mechanism that has allowed, think about Europe, but not only, think about Latin America, even in the Arab world, you will see some examples. I would say also in Asia, yes, not all of it. Less so in Africa, perhaps, but also there is other cases, to maintain, to preserve the historic. But, and this is the but, which I think you're quite interested in. So, this has created also another effect, which we have to be aware of. Essentially, we have created, we have maintained a very high attractivity in the area. You have improved the value of the land and the buildings there. So you've created an area that has high values, you know, and has high value both in terms of economics and in terms of its physical quality. And this is, by definition, the best plate for another actor that has come to this forefront in the world scene, that is the tourists. So we have, in fact, now the original purpose was not to create a tourist city. The original purpose was to maintain, to preserve its historic values and its population. So something that was, considered important for the identity of a place, for its significance, for the life of the citizens, and so on, so on, so on. But the result is that through the districtization mechanism, we have accelerated the production of a tourist package. I'm sorry to say that maybe Professor Semi will talk about that later on, but that's what happened. And it's happened more since the beginning, I would say, in the 70s, 80s, but essentially it's tremendously accelerated in the past 15, 20 years with the emergence of what I consider the most important cultural transformers in the world, that is to say, the low-cost airlines and the apps like Airbnb that allow people to circulate. And now, all these policies here have nothing to do with low costs and Airbnb. In fact, they never thought about. They didn't exist. And before, managers and mayors realize that now these policies were impacting, you know, their historic areas and the way they were essentially distorting the very purpose of the public intervention, the process has happened. Of course, it's not everywhere, I'm not generalizing, but it's strong enough to say that it is the trend. I'm sure even in Bologna you have it now. Certainly in my city, I don't know if you have been to Venice, but it's my city, certainly we have it. And I think tomorrow we're going to Florence, okay, have a look, you will realize. But you know, these are considered today, we also use them as kind of extreme cases, Venice, Florence, you can imagine. But believe me, it's everywhere. It's in Paris. It's in New York, it's in London, it's everywhere. Of course, you see it, maybe perception is different, you know, because in Paris you don't see the same effect. But I can tell you, the city of Paris is extremely concerned of the impact of the tourist, let's call it, appropriation of the housing stock, you know, because this is kicking out the rest of the population. And it's creating a very difficult housing market, you know, where there's no mobility anymore. People are taking away houses from the market, from the normal, regular rental market, by the scores, because it's, you know, the Airbnb market is much more profitable and it imposes less limitations and less costs. To the owner, and it's hard to understand how to deal with these issues. No? But I think it's the core, it's a central issue: how you deal with these issues in order to re-establish what was the original purpose of the public policy that, you know, were, you know, behind this idea of conservation. I don't think we will consider positive just you know, the fact of having spent large sums of public money to create a no-cost product for the tourist industry. I don't think that will be considered wrong, right? We you know, on paper we would consider it wrong, but that's exactly it. So, goods and bads for this model, but you will find it everywhere. I think this model has reached its limits in terms of the ability to manage things, and perhaps also, as you will see, in the discussion that we opened about the historic cities, that we have also trying to look beyond the idea that you can actually, you know, fix one area of the city, just that limit the historicity to an area of the city. Okay, so there are a few examples of this. Exactly, you find this is Cambridge, where you find. Now, one thing that has happened also in this past 30, 40 years is that, in fact, the historic city, as I was saying, has been, in fact, now fully identified as heritage. It took a long time. It took, I would say, at least maybe 30, 40 years of thinking and elaboration by specialists and so on, and then maybe 30, 40 years of, you know, for the public to respond with legislation, local and national, and so on. But you know, most of, if you think about Europe, most of the countries have now their own regulations and laws for conservation of urban heritage, and many other regions also, maybe not as developed as expanded. I think one of the key actors of this transformation has been the World Heritage Convention, which I had the privilege of directing for 10 years, when moment of boom of its capacity, you know, to drive processes and to push policies for conservation. The one that is measured today is the key national heritage conservation tool. It's the most important, the most famous, the most recognized and most universal. 193 countries have ratified this treaty, and there are over 1,000 sites inscribed in the World Heritage List. Exactly. whole half is either of urban heritage or heritage that is linked to an urban context. So it is the most dominant category of heritage worldwide. Now, this is a fact. Could have been different. In fact, at the beginning was different. At the beginning there were very few cities. You know, heritage was essentially archaeology and monuments. But cities became very, very important throughout the decades. I think for one reason, which maybe is not clearly expressed, but it's behind very, very evident, the fact that cities have a mayor, a political process, a population, you know, and they are more easy, say, easy for them to bring their own name forward in the heritage selection process, then, you know, perhaps prehistoric sites or things that are no mayor and no population. So the result is that we have now a very large number of cities, so we have an enormous sample. We have cities of all the regions. Of course, you know very well the European cases, you know, very important, the city of Florence, Russia, is important, all the Eastern European, Poland, this is Krakow country. But also the Mediterranean basin has been now very important heritage is Rabat, it's been described recently, Algiers, we have Jerusalem, of course, Turkey, we have, and then of course you go to the east, Isfahan, Iran, Arab world also, Jeddah I mentioned earlier, but it's also there is a historic area. Sana'a, although today very threatened by war, it's a very important historic center. Hadramaut, these, you know, fantastic earth and architecture cities. Africa, you know, the Djenné, for instance, very important in Mali, or Timbuktu, or this Gramasam, which was described recently, Saint-Louis, Senegal, colonial cities also quite important. The Latin America experience of city development after the Spanish conquest, Quito, in Cusco, this is very nice to see this hybridation of the ancient Inca city and the Spanish, Bahia or Rio de Janeiro. I mean, you have worldwide a very great spectrum. In Asia, of course, Kyoto is very important, but the Chinese are very strong actor in the World Heritage Convention, put a lot of sites. And this is not only concerned the, say, old sites. In fact, the World Heritage Convention has been a very interesting experiment, also innovation in the identification of heritage. And we have many other types of heritage, urban heritage, for example, the modern heritage. We have Chandler, which is essentially 1950s Corbusier planning, the Brazilian, which is 60s by Meyer and Lucio Costa. We have the Arbor, which is, you know, post-war construction, modernist style, French city. We have Tel Aviv, which is 1930 Bauhaus. And just to give you very, really in a flash, the complexity, the richness and the complexity of this element, of the city as a heritage. And today, this has been established, the World Heritage Convention is dominant in the world of heritage, it's very, very well known, recognized, and so on. Of course, it's not solved all the problems. Now, the conservation of these cities is complex, difficult. This is why, in fact, while we were looking at this issue 15 years ago, we realized that, you know, the definitions that are used by the convention, the mechanisms that are supported, the processes and the tools were quite insufficient. You know, there was no good understanding of the variety, the diversity of this heritage in different parts of the world, and on ways to address certain issues that were on front. You have to understand, and I think you've seen it in this presentation so far, that most of the ideas around urban heritage were born in Europe. This is essentially a European idea, which I don't consider a negative. On the contrary, I think it's important, and it's very rich and very important. But we have to know where it comes from. It comes from Europe, so it is an extension to the rest of the world of a European. here, which finds has found has encountered say favor of other cities because in fact you know, it proposes a very good model of identification and preservation, but you know not necessarily you know respects the diversity of all the complexity of this heritage around the world. For instance, I do a lot of work in Asia and I realize that you know Asian cities are completely different in terms of their construction, the material, the very material in which they are built, and the way in which they are lived and used and so on. Try to go to Indonesia or India, you realize that it's very difficult to apply the same concept, the same idea. Certainly, at least in terms of basic things on the perimeter, for instance, and defining a perimeter, defining an area around the buffer zone, around the area, these basic tools for preservation, I think the model has been successful. I think we were not able to address many other issues, which in fact are the reason why we, in the past 15 years, have developed this concept that we call the historic urban landscape. I'd like to spend a few minutes on this because I think it's an important innovation in the approach. The historic urban landscape is essentially a recommendation of UNESCO. And UNESCO has different normative tools. I mentioned earlier the conventions, which are international treaties that have been ratified by every member state in order to become effective. And then there are other that we term soft law, soft laws, which are the recommendations. They are not binding. They are essentially guidelines, but they're not binding. When 2011, which is only 7 years ago, after a process that took at least 7 or 8 years, we were able to have this UNESCO recommendation on the historic urban landscape being adopted by the General Conference. I think this is the first ever recommendation on cities done by UNESCO, and the first recommendation on heritage in the past 40 years. So it was kind of something significant in terms of, because it was the first time that UNESCO revised its original principles and concepts on heritage and tried to write the text that was more open to modern ideas and modern principles and approaches than the historical ones. You will see what I mean later on when I talk about ways in which we try to connect these two different worlds of conservation and development, which sometimes seen in opposition. We think, on the contrary, that it is possible to work them together. Now, in a nutshell, what is the historic landscape idea? It's very simple. That instead of taking the city as a monument, essentially a group of housing or group of buildings of different values, we take them as a